Scott, you've started the thing.
Yes.
I've started a chapter called The Renormalization Group. It's chapter 18, the online book. So you can go to that and find things. Now, so what I want to redo is the renormalization group for QED. And the idea is that if you consider scattering like this, that's the lowest order diagram. And then if you add to it this diagram, which we already computed, then this is the vacuum polarization diagram, and then the amplitude is a function of Q squared, where this is Q, and Q squared then is P1 minus P1 prime squared. And so this is typically greater than zero for a physical scattering process. And there are also other diagrams, such as vertex corrections, but I'm ignoring them for this right here. So this is then E renormalized squared times 1 plus pi of Q squared. And pi of Q squared is, again, E renormalized. This is E renormalized at Q equals zero, divided by 2 pi squared, integral 0 to 1, x, 1 minus x, log 1 plus Q squared, x, 1 minus x, m squared, dx. Okay. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to do something very much like what I did for 5 and 4th, because I think that's a more physical approach. So we're going to say that the running coupling constant squared is now going to be A at mu squared, or mu squared much greater than m squared. And the reason for that is that when q squared is much greater than m squared, we can just pull, we can ignore the 1, and this integral becomes much simpler. And so this is, in other words, it's E renormalized squared, 1 plus pi of mu squared. So this is going to be our definition of E renormalized squared. Now, pi of mu squared is just this integral at very large mu squared. And so what it turns out to be is E squared over 6 pi squared log of mu over m minus 5/6, oddly enough. And in fact, I'm going to just assign this as a Hallmark problem to go from here to there. And there's a hint. Of course, you go to the, you ignore the 1 because you're q squared much bigger than m squared. And then when you have the log of something, the log of a product is the sum of the logs. Use that. And in particular, if you try to use, you can use XMAPLE or Mathematica if you want, but if you just gave this whole thing to Mathematica, I think it would choke. Okay. But if you instead split this thing up into, you write this as log of Q squared over M squared plus log X plus log 1 minus X, and then multiply all that by x, 1 minus x, integral 0 to 1 dx. Again, it might choke, but give it this, I mean, you will, give it this term separately, then give it this term, then give it that term, and you should compute all of them. And get that as your answer. And so this amplitude, A of Q squared is then E mu squared times 1 plus pi of Q squared divided by 1 plus pi of mu squared. So that's the amplitude. And what I've done there is simply write E squared as E mu squared divided by 1 plus pi of mu squared. And in fact, I'm now going to write this in a somewhat simpler form. Pi, of course, is small because E squared over 4 pi is 1 over 137. So this expression is small. And so this is 1 plus pi of Q squared times E mu squared, and then this is 1 minus pi of mu squared. Okay, just 1 over 1 plus epsilon is 1 minus epsilon. And so now I'm going to insist that this cross section of as a function of Q squared be independent of mu squared. So we set that equal to 0. So this is, and we might as well ignore this prefactor because obviously it doesn't depend on mu. So this means you have 2 e mu d e mu d mu times 1 minus pi of mu squared minus e mu squared d pi d mu pi of mu squared, that's all equal to 0. Let me get another piece of chalk. Okay. Well, pi of mu squared, of course, is small, and so I'm going to, in other words, this equation is 2 e mu d e mu d mu is then e mu squared over, if you want, 1 minus pi of mu squared, but I'm going to ignore that pi of mu squared, times d pi d mu. And now where is pi of mu squared? Pi of mu squared is this. So d pi d mu is just simply e squared over 6 pi squared, 1 over mu. So that's all that is. And so this expression then is, if we ignore the pi of mu squared, which is small, this is e squared, it's E mu squared times E renormalized squared divided by 6 pi squared, 1 over mu. Okay. And so now, to get rid of this mu, we multiply over here by mu, and we divide by 2 E mu, and so we get the equation mu d E mu d mu is, which is, of course, by definition, the beta function of mu. This is then equal to E, and if I just do it right, it's E mu E squared over 6 pi squared. Okay, so that's what that is. Now, what is the relation between E mu squared and E squared? They differ by something of order E squared. So, since we already have something that's order E cubed, we can replace this by E mu cubed, E mu squared, and the correction is of order E to the fifth. So we can ignore that. So this is our equation mu is e mu cubed over 6 pi squared. I forgot to divide by 2. This 2 turns the 6 into a 12. So this is 12 pi squared. All right, so this is 12 pi squared. And now we can integrate that equation. So we integrate mu from m to e. This is in other words, let's rewrite this equation as d mu over mu is equal to d e mu over e mu cubed times 12 pi squared. So this thing is d mu over mu from m to e. That gives us the log. And on the other hand, this is twelve pi squared integral d e mu over e mu cubed. And now we're integrating that from e sub m to e sub e. And this integral gives you a 1 over, in other words, it's 12 pi squared, the integral of minus 1 over e mu squared divided by 2, actually. And we're doing this from em to ed. And so this is 6 pi squared times 1 over e squared sub m minus 1 over e squared sub e. Okay. And now we can rewrite this as log e over m divided by 6 pi squared is equal to 1 over em squared minus 1 over e squared. And so 1 over e squared is equal to 1 over em squared minus 1 over 6 pi squared log e over m. Now we just invert both sides and we get e squared is equal to 1 over 1 over em squared minus 1 over 6 pi squared log e over m. And then we multiply top and bottom by em squared. So we get em squared over 1 minus em squared over 6 pi squared log e over m. So this is our running coupling constant. And
do you have your adapter, your power adapter? Is it in or around somewhere?
What do you mean by power adapter?
I think you plug it in to charge it. I've read that sometimes it doesn't like an extra monitor without the power adapter.
Okay, it's in my backpack, which is on a chair in my office, yeah. And it's in one of the bags.
Okay.
In the middle bag. Basically. Okay. So, this is not supposed to be M, it's supposed to be E. So what this tells us is that as E exceeds M, this log creeps up from 0 and crowds in on this 1. And so EE squared is greater than EM squared. And I should have graphed that. But anyway, so if this is M and this is E, then it's going up, but it goes up slowly because it's just a logarithmic dependence. And alpha is E squared over 4 pi, and And so alpha, if we take it to be mu squared over 4 pi, it's, let me show you how to do that. This is one of the cute things about alpha. You just stick it in and it attaches magnetically.
Cool.
So if you pull it off, it it doesn't yank the laptop onto the floor. Okay? So, alpha at zero, so we have a running coupling constant. Alpha at zero is just E renormalized squared over 4 pi, and this is 1 over 137. If you just take into account what we're doing today, which is just an electron loop, then alpha at 91 JeV is, let me see, I thought I had that written down, but I don't see it here. Unfortunately, I didn't write that down. What I have is what this is if we include not only electron loops, but also muon loops, quark loops, tau loops, any charged particles that are below around 91 GeV. Then this thing is 1 over 129, effectively, at 91 GeV. So you see it's increased from 1 over 137 to 1 over 129. And as you go up in energy, it continues to drop down. Okay, now, any questions about... All right, hold on, let me get another piece of chalk. Because I may have plugged this, I mean, this may be the wrong adapter and it may be in the wrong thing, you know?
Well, I mean, it looks like the right thing.
It looks like.
Not much else in there. I mean, I don't see another.
You could,
Because everything else is either FireWire or USB.
Or Thunderbolt.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. What is it?
By the computer differentiate which is zero.
Why did I say dA cubed squared dμ squared equals zero?
Yeah.
Okay. That's the basic idea of running coupling. It's that the amplitude is a function of Q squared, and it shouldn't depend upon the scale at which we renormalize. So in other words, it should be possible. In other words, this expression here should give the right answer at any Q squared. And in particular, if we pick, of course, this isn't the whole amplitude. I've left out delta functions and factors of pi and I and so forth. But this is the core, the essence of the amplitude. And the point is that that we should be able to compute it at a small value of mu, or a large value of mu, or an extremely large value of mu. And whatever value of mu we choose, the thing should be independent of mu.
So is that mu squared or just d mu squared or just d mu?
Oh.
Oh, I misspoke.
Sorry, I was belaboring it for you. And of course, you know, another way of saying this is that when you take e mu squared and divide by 1 plus pi of mu squared, what you're left with is just e squared, so there's no mu there at all, really. All right. That's another way of thinking about it. Okay. All right, now let's talk about something a little bit different. Let's think about computing, well, first of all, let's think about an action. It's an integral dd of x of some L, and this is going to be dd x of a half d phi squared plus, and now I'm going to write this as just a sum, lambda n phi to the n. So this is what we were talking about a little bit last time, and this, I'm thinking, you can think of this as field theory in d dimensions, and this is Euclidean.
It's effectively an energy term.
And so we consider a partition function z of lambda to be a path integral e to the minus s d phi, but now we can imagine what we're thinking about here is integrating only over k squared less than lambda squared. In other words, we have a cutoff. Lambda is a momentum cutoff. And the question is, how do we compare that with z of b lambda, which is the integral b lambda e to the minus s d phi, where now the cutoff is, instead of being lambda, it's b lambda, where b is less than 1 and greater than 0. And so in effect, what we're doing here is we're making the space blur, we're looking at a bigger distance scale. And so one way of thinking of it is that this S sub B S of B is integral. We can think of it as ddx, but now we can rewrite x as x prime over b. So x is spread out, it's bigger because b is less than 1. This L of phi here. And so this is going to be dd of x prime, but then b to the minus d. And we have here 1 half of the derivative of
the derivative squared plus the sum
lambda n phi dn. And this is d by dx, but we want to turn that to d by dx prime. And so d by dx, of course, is d by dx prime, dx prime, dx, and x prime is bx. So this is b d by dx prime. And so this thing is then integral ddx prime, b to the minus d, a half b squared d prime of phi squared plus this sum lambda n phi n of the blurrier x. And now what we want is we want to change the definition of phi so that we want to rescale phi so that these b's cancel. And if we rescale phi, then what we get is dd x prime. What does this look like? It's 1 half b to the 2 minus d times d prime phi squared plus this sum lambda to the n phi to the n. And in fact, this is b to the minus d that comes across here. Okay, so what we do is we say phi is equal to b to minus 2 over 2 times phi prime, and now this thing is an integral dx prime 1/2, and now when you square that, you get d minus 2, that cancels this. So this is just phi prime squared, but now over here we have b to the minus d, lambda n, and then phi to the n means that we have b to the n d minus 2 over 2, phi prime to the n. So we can rewrite this as integral ddx prime 1/2 phi prime squared plus a sum lambda prime n phi prime to the n. And so now our z of b lambda looks just like z of lambda, but the only difference is that we have different coupling constants. And the different coupling constants are lambda prime to the n is b to the n d minus 2 over 2 minus d times lambda sub n. And so that means then that these coupling constants change as you go to a larger distance scale, or equivalently have a more severe momentum cutoff. In effect, you're changing by the coupling constants by this amount here. And this, the amount that you change depends upon the power of n in the interaction, and also the dimension of the space-time that you're working in. And so we can, now b, remember, is less than 1. So if this power up here is positive, then as you make the, as you impose a more severe momentum cutoff, or equivalently look at a wider distance scale, a more coarse-grained view of the physics, if this exponent is positive, then that lambda goes down. If it's negative, it goes up. And there's also the possibility that this exponent is zero, in which case it doesn't change. So if n over d minus 2 over 2 minus d is greater than zero, then the coupling constants get smaller, and that, and from the point of view of condensed matter physics, where we're looking at, we're trying to figure out what the properties are of matter in the bulk rather than matter on a scale of angstroms where you see the individual atoms. If this is positive, then lambda prime is going to be smaller, and these things are called irrelevant. Irrelevant from the point of view of condensed matter physics. So these are irrelevant interactions. If n times d minus 2 over 2 minus d is equal to 0, then they're called marginal. And then the other possibility is if n d minus 2 over 2 minus d is less than 0, then they're called relevant. So these are the interaction terms that are most important. And so let's look at a particular case. Suppose we take n equal 2. Then this power is d minus 2 minus d. It's minus 2. So it's less than 0. So that means that mass terms are always relevant. On the other hand, suppose we're looking at the term 5 to the 4th, then n equals 4, and then n over 2 is 2, and so we have 2 d minus 2 minus d, and this is d minus 4, so this is marginal in 4 dimensions, but in 3 dimensions it's relevant because it's minus 1, and in higher than 4 dimensions it's irrelevant. So in particular in 4 dimensions this is a relevant operator, but in 3 dimensions for condensed matter physics it's in fact so it's marginal in 4, relevant in condensed matter in 3 dimensions. What's interesting, and what I'm surprised at is that I'm taking this from a book by Z called Quantum Field Theory in a Nutshell. Let's look at say n equals 5, or let's take n equals 6. For n equals 6. What we have is 6 over 2 is 3, so we have 3d minus 2 minus d is 2d minus 6. And so if we're in 4 dimensions, that's 2 for d equal 4. For d equal 3, it's 0. So this is marginal. So this interaction would be marginal for condensed matter, but it would be irrelevant for quantum field theory, which is in 4 dimensions at least. And that's, I think this is interesting, and I'm surprised that he didn't say anything about it. What it means is, what it seems to me to mean, is that these are in fact unrenormalizable interactions, 5 to the 6th. Is not renormalizable in 4 dimensions. And this thing is saying that in fact it's irrelevant as you go to bigger distance scales, you put in more of a cutoff. And so that seems to suggest that these theories that are non-renormalizable in 4 dimensions might be okay because these terms that are the cause problems are in fact irrelevant terms in 4 dimensions. Alright, well that's the end of that. Now the rest of the stuff that I was going to talk about today is what I was going to. I got some email from Michael Kreutz. In fact I sent him email. Told him that the students were interested in lattice field theory, lattice gauge theory, and also lattice simulations of condensed matter. And so he pointed me to his website, which there are sort of two websites. This is amazing.
Yeah.
You sure this is the right connector?
I'm not absolutely sure, but I don't see anything else that could. It says it's got a mini display port VGA.
All right. Well, let me tell you the two websites. I'll put these up on the webpage, but I might as well tell you them now. phy.phy.bnl.gov. And this will work unless the Republicans shut down the government. Tilda Kreutz.
It's birthday.
And Z2 is the place that he was suggesting that we look. And in fact, the Z2 is a file that I've converted to PDF and you can look at. It's a lecture he gave in a summer school, I think in 2000. And in particular, what he does is he just reviews lattice gauge theory and then talks about some projects. And these projects are some experiments that he's suggesting. And one thing he suggests is, now this is for the Z2 gauge theory. One thing he suggests is a thermal cycle. He also, by the way, writes down a program for both program for Z2, or it's probably for Zn, actually. I printed it out but didn't bring it with me. Anyway, and he also has one for SU3, or perhaps SUN, I'm not sure, maybe two, no fermion. And for the Z2, this one is in C, the SU3 one is in C++. And in fact, let me just mention what the other website, so it's nothing works.
No. It looks like the right idea. The little symbol there isn't the normal little symbol for this. I mean, normally you see this little symbol and it's got a little different line, but I don't see anything else that's even close on here.
And I didn't damage anything by putting it in.
No. I mean, if it's, I mean, it looks like the right thing. We'll have to play with it, figure out.
Yeah, why don't you ask all the Mac users, Dinesh and Bernd and Ivan.
Yeah.
All right. Let me see what the other, well here, I can figure out what the other website is by just bringing up.
Hello.
Boy, this is weird. This is really loose. Do you know how to, this thing still thinks it's connected to the well, all right, let me just. What's going on? All right, I'll leave that. I think the other website, since I'm a little reluctant to, the computer seems to be in a funny state here. My memory is that it's latticeguy.net. Okay. And here is where he has the SU3 program. Up here is the Z2, so that's the Z2 program. And he describes various things that he might do. One is a thermal cycle. You start ordered, and you set beta equal to 1. And then you update while you gradually reduce beta to 0. So this means that you're increasing the temperature. And then you reheat back. Wait a minute. Beta equals, let's do beta. Beta is 1 over kT. And so if beta is going to 0, T is going to infinity. Yeah, I was right. So you're heating. And then you reheat. He says back to beta equal 1. That's a lower temperature. In any event, the idea is you do the simulation for various values of beta here, and as you're going one way in beta, it's like this, you come back the other way, it's like that, and the gap in between is hysteresis. So that's one thing to look at. Another thing is you set beta equal to some beta critical, which you call beta t, which turns out to be 1/2 the natural log of 1 plus root 2. And at this particular value, you start ordered, you update 100 times, start random, update 100 times, and what you should find is distinct final states because you're at a value of the coupling that is a critical value in some sense. And then you can do mixed starts where you order the lattice, randomize the first third, run for beta near this value, and the appropriate phase takes over, and then what you do, you can then figure out what this beta is, this critical value is, to see what value of beta is the one where you can have different phases taking over, according to whether you're slightly high or slightly low. Then you can do it in different dimensions. So in other words, it's Z2, but the dimensions of the lattice, the space-time dimension, you have D equal to 2, there's no transition. D equal 3, it's a second order phase transition, and it's a kind of icing model. D equal 4, it's first order, and D equal 5, he said first order with a question mark. I've never worked in Z2, so I don't know what he means, whether he means that it's something that might not be first order, or whether the student is supposed to figure out what it is. And then other possibilities are you change the action from the action I wrote down to one that S is a gauge beta where you have a sum over UP plus another coupling where you have a sum SI UIJ SJ. So the idea is that this UI is the group element, which is just one or two, I mean one or minus one for Z2. For U1, it's E to the I theta, and you're coupling the two spins like that. And you have limiting cases then if this is much bigger than that, then you have you recover Z2 gauge theory. If this is much bigger than that, then you recover an icing model. And he refers to one of his papers for that. Okay, I think maybe we ought to just quit here. I will put this, I put all this on the webpage. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I just curious.
Actually, you never got a candy for your question. So let me give you an almond joy here. And what's your other question?
Is there any application of the...
Here, you got the second candy of the second question. What?
So any application of this formula by the n equal to 6?
Is there, in other words, what theory in condensed matter would be relevant?
Yes.
Gosh, I don't know. I haven't worked much in condensed matter, so I can't really tell you. What did we say? We said that for when n is 6, it was up there, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So it's 2d minus 6, so it's marginal in condensed matter.
Yes.
I'm
curious because it seems contradictory.
It seems contradictory?
Yeah.
In what sense?
Because the dimension four is irrelevant.
Yes.
But in dimension three is
marginal.
Yeah. I know, is that possible to coexist in the system?
I don't understand.
I don't know if that makes sense in one system.
Well, anyway, I don't know. It's in other words, what this is saying is that it seems to be saying that in quantum, in four-dimensional quantum field theory, the phi to the sixth, as you look, has less and less effect as you look for more on a broader distance scale, or use a more severe cutoff, but that in three dimensions, the coupling constant stays the same, and it always has the same weight. But all right, why don't we quit?